Petersburg. That decision, we are told, will be made on Friday. Right, now let me turn to another expert here, geostrategist for Ukraine and that part of the world. Professor Taras Kuzio is joining us from The Hague. He's with the think tank, the Henry Jackson Society. Professor Kuzio, thanks for being there.
Thank you.
A lot of people thought that Putin wouldn't go ahead. He would threaten, he would bluster, but not actually do anything. He has.
Yes, he has. Until about a week ago, I was also of the same opinion that this is too crazy a thing to even contemplate. I mean, we are living, after all, in the 21st century, not in the sort of the Cold War or the late 19th century. But things began to sort of get darker and more dangerous, I would say, in the last week, particularly Monday and Tuesday of this week. People like myself have been following this for a long time, which many of these aspects of why he's doing this have been around, I think, which these have been missed by, I think, Western journalists and Western policymakers. Putin first made territorial claims on Ukraine as far back as 2008, and he's been doing this on a regular basis since. And he's also been talking about the non-existence of Ukraine and the non-existence of a Ukrainian people. He sees this as Russian land and Ukrainians as Russians. This is not that new. Where it's new is that he's up the ante, as it were, compared to 9 years ago, where he didn't go in a full way. Now he's doing the full whack, as it were.
And what could we suppose, because we don't know his mind, and none of us do, but what would... Okay, well, that in itself, of course, is revealing. But what would be a satisfactory outcome? Because the complete collapse of the country and being subjugated into Moscow's power is unlikely to happen. It can't happen, can it?
I think that's unlikely. The country is just too big in terms of size. It has a very large army. It's the third largest in Europe. It has up to a million reservists. Half a million of those have combat experience in the Donbass over the last 8 years. So yes, this will be a very difficult thing for Putin to digest. It will give him a lot of stomach pains. His goal, which he could never achieve by a small invasion, his goal, it seems now, is, I think, twofold. The first one would be to try to get the current president, Volodymyr Zelensky, to capitulate, to basically surrender and agree to his terms. I don't think that's likely. And if that fails, to move into the big cities, take over the city of Kyiv, which is 4 million people, and impose a pro-Russian satrap, a dictator, along the lines of Lukashenko in Belarus. The danger here is that Putin thinks that this is possible, this is feasible. But it would be only feasible with massive bloodshed, and I don't exaggerate here, massive bloodshed on a scale we have not seen since World War II, and Yugoslavia, of course, in the late 1980s.
And God forbid that should ever come about. What do you read into the nature of the incursion so far? And we're dealing, let me be completely honest here, we've got an incomplete picture. We've got rather random reports coming in. Surprisingly little video, actually. That could be due with some, in some parts of the country, the internet is down. But we haven't seen that amount of the reports of, for instance, you know, a land, sea and air attack. There are missile attacks, yes. We've seen some helicopters flying around. Nobody seems to know which side they belong. We've seen tank movements. Again, the tanks don't have clear insignia on them. That could be part of the misinformation campaign. Is this just an introduction to war? This is a first flurry, if you like, and he could be doing greater things or more damaging and more deadly things in the coming days.
This is the softening up. This is the softening up of Ukraine before Russian troops come in. Russia never had a huge amount of troops on the border, relatively speaking. It had about 170,000 troops all told surrounding Ukraine. Now, that is only enough to come in on the back of a massive bombardment of missiles and artillery and air force. Because if you compare that to Ukraine has 250,000 troops. And it has also hundreds of thousands of reservists and combat veterans. So 170,000 Russian troops is really not sufficient to do that. So I think the danger here is that Russia is going to create a lot of civilian casualties, a lot of damage, a lot of destruction, and then hope that that those 170,000 troops are going to be sufficient to come in and basically mop up what's left. But I just don't see how that's possible. The country is simply too big, and the Ukrainian army, you know, it might get divided up into groups, but it certainly will continue to fight. Let's not forget, and this is where it becomes really, really unpleasant, that Russia has already drawn up death lists of pro-Ukrainian activists that it describes as fascists or traitors or whatever. And these include politicians, civic activists, journalists, and such like, who are pro-Western, and they are to be either put in camps or executed. This is going to turn very, very bloody if Putin has his way and if he's not stopped very soon.
We'll leave it there for the moment. Thank you very much indeed for your insights. That's Professor Taras Kuzio, who's actually speaking to us from The Hague, Ukrainian geostrategist. He's a member of, he's a research fellow, I didn't use proper title, at the Henry Jackson Society. That's the anti-extremism think tank.